Welcome to FP Executive. We are joined today by Mary Hughes, who is a scientist and a recent graduate of Ivy's MBA program. Mary, it's not usual, I would think, for a scientist to go back and do an MBA. What made you decide to go to Ivy and do an MBA?
Well, I think it's, you know, when you look at the MBA route for a PhD, I agree with you, it is very unusual. You know, I'm the only one in the class that has that background. But at the same time, I think, you know, the Ivy program has made it more and more apparent that that's a good combination. And I think having a strong scientific background and complementing it with the strong business side is not only, you know, instrumental in furthering your career within the industry, within the company, but also on a personal side. And I think those benefits weren't really realized until you're actually in the program. Mm-hmm. And the Ivy program is certainly one of a number of you know, high caliber schools within Ontario, and I think we're very fortunate with that regard. But as a mother with two young children and being married to a professional with an active career of his own, it really came down to what's the best fit on a personal side to complement and enhance what you're doing on a personal level, and to still let you work and still, you know, gain the benefits of understanding the learnings from an MBA program. And so for the Ivy program, it was really not only just the name and the caliber and mm-hmm. where they've ranked as far as executive MBA programs, but it was also the faculty. And one of the smartest things was by joining a session, actually attending a class session, watching Murray Bryant, who was an accounting professor at the time, talk about a business case. And I thought I would be learning about numbers, and right. accounting is certainly not a strength. And so it was strategically chosen. But you're very, you know, it was very surprising to see that the focus was not so much on you know, which particular accounting formulas and principles should you apply to mm-hmm. a certain problem, but understanding the business before you jump into making decisions. Mm-hmm. So there was a very practical element that appealed to everyone, and then putting the classmates themselves, the participants, in the driver's seats and just turning back that discussion saying, what would you do as the manager in this situation? And so, you know, sort of seeing that level of active engagement and getting the enthusiasm from the class, you know, for me it was a perfect fit. And I think it was based on the once a month, you know, classroom format sessions fit well into our schedule. But I think the learning part, you have to be, if you're going to invest that amount of time into something so intense, mm-hmm. you need to be able to enjoy it. You need to realize that you're getting something out of it at the end.
Well, let's talk a little bit about what you got out of it. As a scientist, how did you find sitting in classes where they talked about leadership, for example, which seems to be sort of a term we hear bandied about a lot in the media and at a lot of business schools?
Absolutely.
You know, how do you sit down and say, okay, today I'm going to learn about leadership?
I think, you know, for me, once again, this has definitely been an experience. This has not been getting another degree. And, and I think the experience has been surprisingly humbling. So what I did not expect was to walk away with the level of humility that you do, to realize that you don't know everything. You actually know very little. To understand that on the topic of leadership, leadership is not standing up in front of a group and saying sort of follow me. Mm-hmm. Leadership is recognizing what questions have to be asked, who needs to be involved in the decision-making process, and you know, the best you know, analogy that I like is, you know, you're really the symphony conductor in front of that symphony.
Right.
And so everybody, every functional group has their expertise. Mm-hmm. Can you bring together all those expertises and get them aligned so that they sort of, you know, make one, you know, constructive piece of music together? And that leadership example goes against what you think of. It's not being the loudest. It's not being up in front. It's pushing your team from behind and getting the best out of them. And so the, you know, understanding it from that cross-enterprise leader, that it's not just the medical team or the clinical development team that's important. Mm-hmm. It's the marketing team, it's the finance group, it's our IT groups. How do you support and make sure that everybody's aligned and that you're listening to them? And I think that's one of the key things, that you know, a leader actually listens, does less talking and more listening. And
right.
so from the perspective of, you know, how has that changed? I think my whole definition of leadership has changed dramatically.
I see. Have you been able to employ these lessons in your own work life?
When you leave a session, an IV session on a Sunday evening, you're exhausted. Mm-hmm. I mean, you've just gone through four intense days of understanding new learnings that you're mm-hmm. Assimilating. And I think one of the most exciting things is you can walk into the office on a Monday morning. Mm-hmm. You can take the learnings that, strategy is not just always about saying yes, it's about what you're going to say no to. Mm-hmm. And you can apply that, immediately in a Monday morning session to say, are we being strategic? Have we thought about things that we should also, be saying no to so that we can do a better focus on what we're going to say mm-hmm. yes to? So it's taking the applicability of what happened in those cases, what your classmates have shared with you as experiences, and it's given you an unfair advantage in the workforce. It's made you smarter, so that when you walk into meetings, and people say, "Wow, Mary Hughes, she just seems so clear on that thought," and it's directly mm-hmm. because of what you've just learned, mm-hmm. And it's that whole thought process that has evolved. Mm-hmm. To actually get you to stop to think about, have I considered the important things? Mm-hmm. Have I got the right people together? Do I have a plan of action? Mm-hmm. And how am I going to actually measure what we're trying to do? That whole thought process is integrated into my workplace on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. And you can actually see that it's undeniable. There's a change in the way that you approach people mm-hmm. on a personal and professional level, as well as understanding that you need to be behind a project and to believe in it if you expect that passion to be carried sure. through to your teammates.
Mm-hmm. I have a question. You mentioned that you're a mom as well, a very busy person. How did your family respond when you suggested that an MBA might be something that you wanted to do?
I think, speaking from my perspective, it was a little bit easier because my husband, who practices in a different profession, also had an MBA.
Okay.
And so he knew the experiences of what to go mm-hmm. through. He chose a part-time program and not an executive program. So certainly from that perspective, he understood it. Mm-hmm. The rest of my family, I think, was probably very much like some of your audience members will be, with so many degrees, why an MBA? What is
right.
an MBA going mm-hmm. to teach you? And they just saw it as, lifelong learning. But it was a, in my mind, it's a privilege to be able to go to school while you're working.
Mm-hmm.
It's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity mm-hmm. To go through, what I've experienced in the IV program. It's not just the people that you meet mm-hmm. and what they've experienced. It's being in a setting where you have an opportunity to very safely try on different hats and mm-hmm. try on different decisions and what would that mean and to really understand those implications mm-hmm. and that learning process is unique and different from any other program I've undergone. I mm-hmm. frequently say that with all my years of education, this has brought value in a lifelong sort of sense of looking at things. It's not just directly attributable to what you're going to do in the industry. Mm-hmm. It's how do you approach people and how do you approach difficult situations on a day-to-day basis.
Mm-hmm.
So the value for me has been both very much on a professional and a personal level.
Well, I was struck when you mentioned at the beginning of our interview the humility aspect of this. When did that kick in? Was that like first class or?
I think that was definitely the first class.
Yes.
So when you realize you're surrounded by, a class of 54 mm-hmm. teammates that have vast amounts of experience, vast amounts of courage with the entrepreneurial spirits mm-hmm. and what they're setting up, and you see the backgrounds and the diverse industries where they come from, mm-hmm. You very quickly realize that you're not a finance expert, you're not mm-hmm. an accounting expert, you're not a revenue management expert, you're certainly not a global economy expert, and you start to think, what am I doing here? did they pick the right person?
Mm-hmm.
So everyone is picked because you have something to contribute.
Right.
And I think as much as you contribute and mm-hmm. have the courage to sort of say, I'd like to ask the dumb question, it enhances the learning of everybody, but
right.
it makes you realize that an N of one is not sufficient to be an effective leader.
Mm-hmm.
Leadership is surrounding yourself by the people that whose opinions count. And,
mm-hmm.
It's not just your opinion that counts. It's have you really listened to others? And
mm-hmm.
it's in essence, it's your you're the bottom rung on the ladder and not really the top. And so it has sort of flipped your whole thinking on what you thought success was and what you thought leadership was.
Interesting. Well, Mary Hughes, thank you very much for joining us today. I really enjoyed our talk.
Thanks, John.